Oh. Christus Christus. Good afternoon. Just wanted to introduce myself. My name is Father Lee Jarofsky. I'm the new Chief Administrative Officer for Bishop Newman Junior Senior High School here in Wahoo. Just moved in on Monday and got myself situated, or at least got all my stuff in the box to put into a room. That's about the extent of where I'm at right now. So I think this morning was the first time I woke up and knew where I was at. So making progress, but we'll continue to move forward. Just so you know as well, I've also moved into the White House, the parish offices on the north side of the rectory. So if you see the lights on at 2 a.m. and shadows moving around, don't call the cops, all right? It's just me. I'm up late usually at night working on different things and not falling asleep. So I come to you by way of Seward, where I was born and raised, and graduated from there in 1996, so I know I have some high school contemporaries and classmates and things like that in the area, as well as friends from college, from UNL, where I was a janitor at the Newman Center, and then went on to St. Gregory the Great Seminary for 3 years to finish up my degree, my bachelor's degree, and then Mount St. Mary's. And then after all of that, the bishop still decided to ordain me. So I was ordained in 2006 and served in Plattsmouth, where I was Church of the Holy Spirit for a year. And then St. Michael's in Hastings, where I was an assistant and taught at St. Cecilia's. And then St. John's in Lincoln, where I was also an assistant and taught at Pius X High School. And I went back to St. Cecilia's to be principal for 4 years, and then back to Pius to be the assistant chief administrative officer there, where I learned apparently enough about school and administration to then be called up to go down to the Fall City last year in the midst of the craziness of the priests getting pulled out and removed. I was thrown into the mix down there to keep the school steady and keep things going. And so the last 16 months I've been down there to be a part of that community. Such a good job that they thought I should come up to Bishop Newman and run the school up here. So it's a little bit different. I'm in residence, but my main job is to be at the school and to make sure that that's working appropriately. But being in residence here also affords me the opportunity to be a part of your families, to be a part of your lives, and to be up at 2 a.m. when the phone rings to run to the hospital or to say Mass, to hear confessions, to anoint the sick, bury the dead, baptize the babies, and help out with all the sacraments, or whatever Father Faulkner says I need to do in order to earn my keep at the White House. So it's good to be a part of this community. I look forward to getting to know you and your families over the course of however many days, weeks, months, years the Lord has given unto me. And on this Father's Day, to wish you a happy Father's Day for all the fathers out there, and ask you to continue to pray for fathers, continue to pray for priests who are called fathers, and continue to pray for all those that are going through transition right now in one way or another, that we get settled and remember where we're waking at in the morning to be able to do God's work and God's will. So just a little nugget from my own dad. On this Father's Day, little gifts of wisdom and things to be thinking about. So growing up in Seward, walking the beans and the fields and working calves, and whether it was being a lifeguard at the pool or slaving away in the fields, to be open to God's will. Be open to God's will. So when I decided to go to the seminary, and went home Christmas break to tell my parents that this is what I was thinking God was calling me to, I sat them down and walked through and said, all right, I think God's asking me to make a change. I'm going to finish up one more year at engineering school at UNL, but then I'm going to go to St. Gregory the Great Seminary in the fall. And my dad was like, you feeling okay? Are you crazy? What's going on? I'm like, no, I'm really thinking about this. He's like, you're out of your mind. And he got up and walked out of the room. And my mom was like, well, Lee, you know, okay, I kind of get it, I kind of understand, but maybe you just haven't found the right girl yet, you know? Okay, wow, thanks, Mom. You think that's what Mary told Jesus, you know? No. But then she got up and went to the kitchen. So there I was, like, okay, that did not go as planned at all. A few moments later, my dad walked back into the family room and was standing there awkwardly by the fireplace or the stove, warming himself. And then after a few more minutes, he's like, well, look, Lee, you know, I thought about going to the seminary at one point. And I got in my car and I was driving down to talk to the vocations director, and I went around the block and just drove right back home. I always wondered whether or where, what would have happened if I decided to go in those doors and present myself. So I don't want you to wonder. I want you to know. I want you to know for sure what God is calling you to. So go to the seminary and figure it out. Whether God tells you yes or no, whether you're in for a day, a week, or a month, and you get ordained, whatever God's calling you to, you should respond. And so I'm not going to be in your way. I want you to go and not wonder, but figure out what God wants you to do. So that's my hope and wish and prayer for you as well, that whatever God is calling you to, however he is calling you to live your life, that on this Father's Day, you respond and respect not only your earthly fathers, but also give your heart fully and completely to our Heavenly Father, who is never outdone in generosity and always wants to give you the grace and strength you need to respond to whatever he is calling you to do, whether it's to work as a lifeguard, to work in the fields, be an engineer, be a mother, be a father, and whatever the Lord has given unto you, to hear his call and respond. Because ultimately, that's why I'm here today, to respond to your calls, to be part of your lives, to be part of your communities, to bring you Christ in such a way as to give glory to your Heavenly Father, to be worthy of being his sons and daughters, and to be able to live in his grace now and always. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. A reading from the Epistle of Blessed Paul, the Apostle to the Ephesians. Brethren, to me, less than least of all the saints, this favor was given, to preach to the Gentiles the unfathomable riches of Christ, and to enlighten all men on the working out of the mystery, which for ages was hidden in God, the Creator of all things. So that now through the Church, the manifold wisdom of God might become known to the principalities and powers of heaven, in fulfillment of the eternal decree which he carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord. In him and through faith in him, we can speak freely to God and draw near to him with confidence. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. And I pray that he will bestow on you gifts corresponding to the riches of his glory. May he strengthen your inner selves with power through his Spirit. May Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, and may love be the root and foundation of your life. Thus you will be able to grasp fully with all the saints the breadth, the length, the height, and the depth, and to know that the love of Christ surpasses all knowledge, so that you'll be filled with all the fullness of God. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time, since it was preparation day, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the feast, so that the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a solemn feast. So they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. Accordingly, soldiers came and broke the legs of the men crucified with Jesus, first the one and then the other. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead. They did not break his legs. However, one of the soldiers jabbed his side of the lance, and immediately blood and water flowed out. This testimony has been given by an eyewitness, and his testimony is true. He is telling what he knows to be true, that you too may have faith. These events took place in order that the scripture, to have the scripture fulfilled. None of its bones are to be broken. And still another scripture passage which says, they shall look on him whom they have pierced. I'm still trying to get all the terminology down right, but today is considered the external solemnity of the Feast of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. In other words, Friday, the Friday following Corpus Christi, which we celebrated last week, is the normal day you celebrate the Feast of the Sacred Heart. That makes sense. It's Friday, right? It's the day he's pierced by the lance, as we've heard. It's the day that he invites us to come to his heart. Sacred Heart's going to come first Friday. But in order that the Christian family can celebrate it more largely, we have an external solemnity where we can also celebrate it on the following Sunday. I asked a friend, I said, okay, so if we celebrate it on this Sunday today, can we also celebrate it on Friday, 2 days ago? And his response was, yes, quote, external solemnities are like a 21st birthday being in the week. We celebrate the actual day, but the big party isn't until the upcoming weekend when everybody can make it. That's a cool image right there. So again, today is the external solemnity of the Feast of the Sacred Heart. And this feast is an incredible gift to us, both from the Church and from Christ himself. Because it's not just a feast day that's a gift. There's a specific revelation from Jesus that is the gift here. Now, there already had been a devotion to Jesus' heart earlier, even going back into the Middle Ages, with like St. Bernard of Clairvaux. He wrote a lot of things about Jesus' heart and wrote some beautiful hymns and stuff like that. There was already a mass of the Sacred Heart back in the 1350s, but things really focus on this devotion to the Sacred Heart when God, Jesus himself, reveals his heart in a special way to St. Margaret Mary Alacoque in the year 1673. From 1673 to 1675, those 18 months, he revealed his heart in a special way and said, Margaret Mary, these are things you need to take out to the world. These are things you need to pass on. And the two big things he hit on was the idea of reparation for sins and offenses against his Sacred Heart, but also for us then to come to him for peace and relief and healing, for us to take in that grace and be able to be under his Sacred Heart, that we might be like him and become people who are healed by his heart. And she was invited to push people to consider more frequent communion, the use of the holy hour before the Blessed Sacrament, and the devotions of First Friday. And all those things come from that time of doing that. And a lot of times we hear that, Jesus, why did he wait 16, almost 1700 years to do this? Well, it was specifically to combat the heresy of Jansenism. And you can definitely see how the Sacred Heart does combat a lot of the ideas of the heresy of Jansenism. There's a lot of things that people were not hearing and were not understanding, and it makes sense for Jesus to do that. But that seems pretty small and narrow for Jesus. I think he must have seen many things, many people, many hearts that needed to get to know his Sacred Heart in a different way. They needed healing in a different way. And so that it's not just for one cause, but for many, many causes that Jesus gave us this gift of, let me show to you my heart. Let me reveal this mystery of my Sacred Heart and call you to it. And what's cool is that we weren't just left with this, okay, we got an image of the Sacred Heart over there, maybe I've got some prayers to the Sacred Heart, a litany of the Sacred Heart, but Jesus said, I want to be in your homes. And so one of the big things with the feast, with the devotion to the Sacred Heart is to enthrone the Sacred Heart in your home. Some of you might have grown up with parents or grandparents that had an enthroned Sacred Heart picture on the wall. I know my parents and both sets of grandparents had that enthroned image. And I just took it for granted. I didn't realize until I went to other people's houses that not everyone always had that. So if you don't have that, I'd say look into it. It's a beautiful devotion. It's a beautiful thing. And what we're doing there is we're not just saying, Jesus, I'm going to go to you and seek a chance to take water from the fountain of your heart, as the Pope gave us in describing this feast, but also the idea, you're going to come to me. You're going to come to my family. You're going to settle yourself in my home and with my family. And so then it's just not just a source of healing, but also a source of refuge, that we can go back and be safe in that home that we know is enthroned with Jesus that's there. That when we are tired and worn out, that we can go to him. One of the quotes we use most of the Sacred Heart is when he says, come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Follow after me, for I am meek and humble of heart. When he talks about his heart, he says, come to me and find rest. So take this feast day in, soak it in, and not just, you know, think of like, oh, I can do another devotion. Consider how he can become more part of your family, be in your house, maybe even enthroned in your living room in a special way, so you can always have him, not just as a light in the darkness with his flaming heart and a source of healing, but he might actually be also a refuge for you to come home to every time you return to your home. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Apostolica me grace. Expect all. In Jesus.